Hello and welcome to the Dragonfly Daily. As always, I'm your host, Mike, the product manager of Dragonfly. We are doing another lesson on deep learning. So today's lesson will be on instance segmentation or something called image segmentation. If you're watching this on YouTube, hit that subscribe button, turn it gray. I need lots of subscriptions and I also need lots of likes so I can get the boss to let me keep doing deep learning videos. Today's content is on deep learning. The lesson plan for this series of lessons on deep learning, we started with an introduction of deep learning background material for imaging science applications. Then yesterday's lesson on denoising. Today's lesson will be on image segmentation, which in the literature is often described as semantic segmentation. Then we will talk about super resolution tomorrow and then some other topics in lesson 19. So this is lesson 17, image segmentation with deep learning. I know I corrected that slide. It still says 4. Image segmentation with deep learning, and we will be using Dragonfly 4.1 with some minor customizations that we did in customizing Dragonfly lesson 6. So as yesterday, I mentioned that I'm using my workstation. So the workstation I used for yesterday's lesson is the same I'm using for today's lesson. So in this case, I have a graphics card that cost me about $600 a couple of years ago, and this whole system was about a $3,500 build. So if you have a $10,000 or $20,000 build, you'll have much higher performance than I have right now. But you can even use Dragonfly on more modest hardware. Even my laptop can do the deep learning segmentation. It just goes a little bit slower. The topics for today, we will look at two different image segmentation tasks. We'll look at binary image segmentation, so sort of a single foreground against the background or everything else that is in the background. And we're going to use a denim fabric material from an X-ray microscopy reconstruction from Rigaku. Then we will look at a multi-phase segmentation, so the same data we've been looking at. Oh, you know, I have those completely labeled wrong. So it's actually going to be a multi-phase segmentation of the denim fabric and a single phase segmentation of the HeLa. What we will do is we'll start with the denim fabric, and these are data that I can share, so I'll post these to the Dragonfly sample data webpage where you can download them if you want to repeat this exercise. In this example, which we'll see in just a moment, we're going to segment big fibers from small fibers from background. If you've attended any of my workshops, we've done this as a hands-on exercise, but we're going to do it very quickly here. Then as the second example, which will be the single phase segmentation, this will just be segmenting the mitochondria directly on the noisy HeLa cell images that we've been looking at for a couple of days now. I will note that these data I don't have permission to share, so you won't be able to reproduce that exercise, but I think you'll see all the details from the live demonstration. All right, I'm going to come back to that slide. Now I'm going to switch over to Dragonfly, where I already have my data loaded. I have, as I said, we will start with the denim data, which look like this. I'm going to double click in one quadrant to go full screen. What you can see here in this image is you see some background air, you see some small fibers, and you see some big fibers. The contrast does not have sufficient contrast to normally, or to use normal methods for segmentation. So if I were to try and do some sort of intensity segmentation, it might look like this. And so if I try and segment, I can get some separation, but really there's too much overlap in the histogram for me to try and segment the big particles or the small particles because there's just too much overlap. So that's a good case for deep learning segmentation. Now, what I have done here is I have done some manual segmentation on 3 slices. Let me show you what I have. I'm going to go down to slice number 1. And if you look here, I have segmented some small fibers, and I have segmented some big fibers, and I've done it all inside this area marked by this mask. So I've done a little bit of segmentation on this, and we can use the ROI Painter tools that you saw in lesson number 9. That gave us a good indication of what we need to do this sort of image segmentation, or at least to create the training data for the more detailed image segmentation. So this is slice number 1. Now in this slice, you'll notice that I have big fibers, and in the big fibers, you sometimes see them transverse and sometimes you see an axial cut. I also have small fibers. In this slice, I only see axial cut for the small fibers. That means if I trained just with this, I don't have a very diverse training set, and we might not expect it to do a good job of segmenting any time we see transverse small fibers. So I'm going to go to another slice. I'm going to right-click and choose Set Slice. I'm going to go to slice 281. And here on slice 281, now we see that we have the small fibers also in transverse. Now, if we look at the small fibers I've segmented this area. So basically, I just painted an area, and then I painted a green mask using the segmentation tools. So now we have some examples, again, of small fibers in axial and transverse and big fibers in axial and transverse. So this segmentation took me about 45 seconds. Now I will right click and do set slice, and I will go to slice 172. So I did segmentation on three slices. Oh, I wrote down slice 172, but doesn't look like I have any segmentation on slice 172. Let's have a quick look over here. So I can see in my cross section that I have, I'll double click. I can see I have some segmentation on this slice and up here. So we'll just go right here, double click, and there it is. Slice 173, I was off by one slice. So once again, we see that we've segmented just small areas. So these three, I'm gonna use the word patches for now. These three regions of interest are where I have created training data. Now that's all I need to go ahead and set up a deep learning segmentation or a deep learning training to train a model that can do automatic segmentation on the rest of the data set. I'm going to go to tools, deep learning tool, the same place we went yesterday for our denoising models. So here are a couple of models that are already trained. I'm going to create a new model, and this is going to be UNet. And in this case, it's going to be multi-label segmentation. So I'm going to call this lesson 17 denim, lesson 17 denim, and we'll call it three phase. It's going to be the small fibers, the big fibers, and then all the background pixels. I'm going to go ahead and click generate. It's going to create that model. Now I did forget one step. Let's do close. The input for the deep learning model when you're doing a multi-phase segmentation is not the ROI of small fibers or the ROI of big fibers, but a multi-ROI. So I'll click both of these, or I'll click one and then control click on the other, right click and say create multi-ROI from ROIs. Now I have this. So I'll turn this off and I'll turn this on, and we'll relabel this denim multi-ROI for training. All right, so this is what's going to be used as the input. Now over here, I've created this model, lesson 17 denim three phase. If I do go to training, and for data set for input, I will say I want the denim XRM image stack, and I want the denim multi-ROI for training as the output. Now in this case, it has detected that there is only painting on three different slices. So if you have painted those entire three slices, you can use an automatically generated mask. Now that means it's going to use the entire field of view on each of those slices, but not on any of the other slices as the training input. Now what this means is that if I use that, it would consider all of the purple to be one material and all of the red to be another material and everything else to be the third material. Now that's clearly not what I need. I need it to restrict its interpretation to the mask, which is why I created a specific ROI for a mask. So I will tell it I want to use the denim mask ROI. Now that has set up the input for the training. I'm going to use data augmentation, and I'll turn up some data augmentation. We'll just turn this up to 3. We're gonna allow for flipping horizontal and flipping vertical. I'm gonna describe what that means in a few moments. And we'll leave validation turned on at 20%. Now under training parameters, I'm actually gonna leave all of these parameters as they are, and I'm gonna go ahead and click train. Now it's going to start the training. There's very little training data, and it's well, it's just very little training data, and it's not a very complicated network to train, so it's going to train pretty quickly. All right. Now, what we will do is we will look at the parameters here in the slides. So I just went through these parameters. We're going to look at them so we can understand what they mean. We're going to look at these parameters as that model trains. So what happens when you do a deep learning training is it decomposes your input and your output into small patches. The patches can be overlapping or non-overlapping. So we have those areas, and in this case, I have on my training parameters, I've set the input patch size to 32. It says 128 in this figure, but when I just ran it on the denim, it was 32. That means that of the large area where I have training data, it will grab a 32 by 32 pixel patch, and then it will move over and grab another 32 by 32 pixel patch. And so for each of those patches, I have the input image and I have the segmented image. In this case, I'm using non-overlapping patches, which is defined as a stride to input ratio of 1. If I wanted to use overlapping patches, I could put this as 0.5, and then I would have effectively twice as much training data, but I would be using some of the training data twice. The number of epochs we will come to in just a moment. what happens in the training cycle of deep learning is it will take a patch, one of the hundreds or thousands of patches that it has created, and it will push it through the network and get an output. And then it will compare that output to the ground truth output and evaluate the cost function that we described yesterday. It's going to do that, but it's not going to update the network weights right away. So let me explain. Over here, you see I have data augmentation. Let's suppose that in this data set, I have a total of, let's say, 800 patches. If I have a total of 800 patches and I set data augmentation, let's do it this way. Let's suppose I have 100 patches. I do augmentation times 3, and now I have 400 patches total. If I turn on validation and I say set aside 20% of my data, it will set aside 20% of the non-augmented data to be used for validation. Then it will take the remainder of the data that is not set aside, and it will put it through the network one patch at a time. After 32 patches have gone through the network, it will look at the aggregate loss function from all 32 of those patches and then update the network weights. Then it will repeat with the next batch of 32 patches. So it will repeat this with every batch until it's gone through all 300 patches that we have total, or at least the 80% that are not being used for validation. So the network updates, the model updates, only happen after every batch. So a higher batch size will make for a more computationally efficient training. A lower batch size will make the training take a little longer. But there are some trade-offs. If I use a very large batch size, it will take a lot of memory on the GPU, and you might want more granularity, I would say, in the training. You might want the weights to update more frequently rather than after a very, very large batch. After it has processed all of the patches that are not in validation, so all of your training patches, including the augmented patches, that is the end of the first epoch. At that point, it will now push through all of the same training data again and give you a loss function. It will report out the loss function for that batch of training data, and then it will also report out the loss function for the validation data. That's the end of the first epoch. Then the whole cycle is repeated for a second epoch. Now, if I go over to Dragonfly, it's already finished with all 50 epochs. You can see that in the first pass, the training data had an accuracy of 73% and a loss function of 0.8. The validation data had an accuracy of 66% and a loss function of, or sorry, the validation data had accuracy of 66% and a loss function of 1.3. You want to see the loss function fall, which it does. As we scroll down, we see that we're approaching 98% accuracy, and we have a loss function that continues to fall. Now, if I take this data, we will scroll to another slice of the data where we didn't use any training, and we'll select the data, and over here we'll ask it to do a preview. Now, we didn't do very much training. This was just a very, very quick example, but if I ask it to apply a preview, you're going to see what the results look like. So it's not perfect, but you see a much better job than any naive segmentation. So we see that the result of the segmentation here is it did a pretty good job of identifying the small fibers, maybe a couple of false negatives on the small fibers there, and a couple of false positives on the big fibers here. Although, gosh, those do look like big fibers, maybe because of the segmentation. Interesting. So what you see here is a very quick example with just a little bit of training data and a few cycles, and you can get useful predictions. Now, you could add more training data to get a better result, and of course, you can train for more cycles. Now, what I'd like to do is now look at, this was a multi-phase or a multi-material segmentation. Now we're going to look at a two-phase segmentation, which is basically we're just going to segment out the mitochondria from everything else in the HeLa cell. And I'm very sorry, at the beginning of this on the denim, I did mean to say that these are, as I mentioned, the X-ray microscope data of denim fabric courtesy of Rigaku. These were collected on a Rigaku Nano 3DX. Thank you to Aya Takase and her colleagues in Rigaku America's office. Now, we've done that segmentation, and I want to have a look at the HeLa data again. Recall that we were looking, and I'll just save this model in case I want to come back to it. I'm going to close my deep learning tool for now. So these are the data we were looking at. They're quite noisy, and suppose we want to segment some mitochondria. What I have done is I have used the marked slices tool to extract 5 slices, and I'm going to show you those 5 slices now. So here are 5 slices from throughout the stack, and they're at slightly different spots in the HeLa cell, and they have mitochondria that I'm interested in segmenting. If I now look at the manual segmentation of the mitochondria, this is what it looks like. So it didn't spend very much time, but you can see what the segmentation looks like on the noisy data. So we see some things that are mitochondria, and we see other things that are just ER or other organelles. So we could spend time perfecting this training data, but what we have right now is 5 training slices that didn't take too much time. Now, in this case, I have also painted a mask. So in this case, I don't want to use the entire image as patches for my training data because I don't want to spend a lot of time learning how to segment this air. I think just a few examples are going to be fine. And I want it to have some balance of areas that have mitochondria and areas that don't have mitochondria. I also want to make sure I include some of the nucleus because I want it to not positively label mitochondria in the nucleus. So it's important to have some training data in all the representative areas of the image. So these are the masks I've just painted very quickly for this training example. Now, if I go back to tools and I go to deep learning tool, I can again create a new model, and in this case, I'm going to choose a binary segmentation, and I'll click generate. This is going to create a new UNet model with random weights, and it's designed for a binary segmentation. I forgot to name it. Let's name it here. We'll call this lesson 17, Mito from Noisy Gila. All right, so that's the name of our model. Now we will do go to training, and here I will choose as input my 5 slice noisy stack, and as output, I will choose my manually segmented mitochondria on 5 slices, and I will use the training mask that is marked up for 5 slices. I'll use the same data augmentation settings, which I think had a factor of 3 augmentation. I'll go to training parameters. Now, in order to identify a mitochondrion, you need a larger field of view than 32 pixels. Let me show you what I mean. This is going to affect how we set this patch size. So if I zoom into this image and I turn off my labels, if I had just 32 pixels, you know, something like this field of view, it's very hard to tell if that's a mitochondrion or not. So you need more context. So in this case, maybe something like this would be enough. This network might have better success if I downsampled it and I didn't try and sample it at such high resolution or used very large patches. Now, I am limited to how large the patch size I can use by my graphics card memory, but I'm going to use 128 pixel patches. That's with a batch size of 32 and a patch size of 128, I'm going to consume about 70% of my graphics card memory. Now, I think that's all I need to do. That all looks good. I'm going to go ahead and click train. Now, this model might take at 50 epochs, it might take 25 or 30 minutes. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to switch over and start taking your questions. When we're done with the questions, or maybe we'll just say at an arbitrary time, maybe 10 minutes from now, we will, or actually, I know I get decent results after just 10 epochs. So maybe if we look over here in 6 minutes after we have 10 epochs, we'll stop and we'll see the results of the training. We can also compare it to a model that I've done with the exact same input data where I have trained for a full 50 epochs. 50 is not a magic number. It's just a default setting here. But if you want to see the difference between training with the same data for, let's say, 10 or 11 epochs versus 50 epochs, we can do that. All right, so the training is underway. We have some accuracy and we have some loss function computed. We're going to let that compute for a little while I take some questions. So, oh, do you know what? Before we get to questions, I do have a couple of things I want to mention. So there are some examples now in the literature of where people have used Dragonfly's deep learning solution for segmentation. Now, this example, which I mentioned yesterday, of silicon carbide ceramic matrix composites. This has not been published yet. This is out for review, where we look at not only the material segmentation of the different phases, but also the cracks. Now, cracks seems to be a pretty popular thing to look at. These are cracks in pharmaceutical tablets. This came out in e-publication in January, and I think in March or April, the publication, the actual print publication came out. And in this case, they're looking at entire tubs of tablets, separating all the tablets in Dragonfly, and then running the deep learning in batch on every one of these tablets in order to segment the cracks and label them. So you see what a naive segmentation looks like here. You can see what a deep learning segmentation of this image looks like in 2D and in 3D. Now, here's another example. So I didn't even know about this paper until Sydney told me about it during the chat dialogue of yesterday's webinar. This is the same image our sample I showed you yesterday on iron ore pellets, it's actually now been published. The EPUB is online. You can see it. And I think the print publication is coming out soon. In this case, they're looking at cracks and they wanted to find the cracks, but they needed to characterize the cracks differentially from the pores, even though they have the same grayscale intensity. So you can check out this paper and see how they're able to segment and characterize the pores and the cracks and understand the three-dimensional nature of the cracks in these iron pellets used in the mining industry. Here's another paper. Now, I confess I haven't read this paper yet. I just learned about it recently. So this is done by workers at Ghent University, and it's been published in Materials, or at least the e-publication is online. This is another 2020 publication. Now, I do not want to oversell this this deep learning for this publication. For one, I have not read it closely, but also I just want to mention that they're actually combining two approaches. They're using deep learning and another method they call variational segmentation to look at woven composites. So you can have a look at this paper and see how the Dragonfly deep learning engine fits into what they're looking at. And I'm just going to check on it. So it looks like I am 5 epochs in. We're going to let that keep going for a little bit and move on to your questions and answers. are there really 16 questions for me already? Let's start at the top. The first question, can you explain why you use the mask? Is it just to save time on manual segmentation of the three slices? Yes, so I could absolutely segment an entire slice, and we often do that. I'll segment an entire slice, train, or maybe segment an entire 3 or 4 or 5 slices. Honestly, there are very few times where I've used more than 5 slices as input to the segmentation training. So in this case, I wanted something that I could show you in the course of a webinar that would go very quickly, and that's why I use the mask. If your data are two-dimensional, like for example, if you have a 2D SEM micrograph that's 40,000 by 40,000 pixels, your whole objective is to segment the entire thing by deep learning, so it makes no sense for you to segment the entire slice manually. So you would want to use a mask in that case. So a mask is just a way of restricting what is fed into the neural network for training. The next question is, can we transfer the weights learned by one model to another model with different architecture instead of starting with random weights? That's a terrific question. We'll talk about that in lesson 19 on advanced topics. We should address transfer learning. It is described in the literature. You can definitely do it when the networks have the same architecture. I'll have to check with my colleagues to see if you can do it when the networks have different architecture. But you can train a network, for example, if you're doing lots of biological imaging of samples that are stained and you're doing SEM stained samples. You could train a network with a large variety of images. You could train it for hours and hours and hours. It would develop the dictionary and the necessary feature understanding of what are the different features that appear in this image. Now, when you train it to segment mitochondria in neurons, and then later you train it to segment ER in HeLa cells, those may be different tasks, but the features that it needs to look at to identify the patterns, to identify your regions of interest, those would be the same features. And so you could use one network to train a master set, and then you can transfer and benefit from the first half of the network being trained in later applications. So we'll try and address that in lesson 19. Next question is, I'm segmenting bone from non-bone on the spine. Do my patch sizes need to be larger than my bones? No, I don't think so. I think your patch size needs to be probably just a little bit larger, maybe 15 or 20% larger than the cortical bone. So as long as your patch is capable of seeing some of the cortical bone and some of the either air or soft tissue around it, then it should be adequate. And of course, that'll be much larger than any trabecular bone that you might see in your vertebrae. Next question is, from Sydney, I think I posted this other publication the other day, but here it is, semantic segmentation of the microstructure of strain hardening cement-based composites by applying deep learning on microcomputer tomography scans. So excellent. Thank you, Sydney. So there's another paper. I only showed you 4. Here's another 2020 paper on people using deep learning in Dragonfly to solve important semantic segmentation. I look forward to reading that paper. I highly recommend you look at the paper that I referred you to in the slides today. In the YouTube video, you will find links to these papers, but the paper in Sydney's does a good job of explaining how the platform in Dragonfly really facilitates that work. So I appreciate that paper. I didn't even know it was coming out, and I'm very excited about it. Next question, is there a data set we can use to follow along on our local Dragonfly install? So thank you, Benjamin, for answering that question. You can look at learn sample data sets. We will post the denim data set later today so that you can reproduce this denim exercise. I will even include the training data and masks, but you could make your own. Might be even be interesting for me to make a little video of showing you how I use the tools from lesson 9, ROI Painter, how to, I can use those to very quickly in 30 to 40 seconds segment those regions. So you can take my tips on how to accelerate your manual segmentation to prepare your training data. Next question is, would it help to train in the reconstructed planes as well? So Benjamin already wrote an answer, theoretically yes, but training is limited to image plane and dragonfly. I'm not sure what PAL means by the reconstructed planes, but you are training in XY planes for all of these networks. You can, in Dragonfly 2020.1, you can use as input not only the single slice you're evaluating, but the neighboring slices, so it can give more three-dimensional context. I'm going to move on to the next question. Lars says, there is some latency on the mouse. Hopefully the video is catching up and you have at least have the audio to describe what I'm going through. Next question. Andrew says, can you make the background noise an ROI to remove it from other ROIs? Sure, you can do that. You can make the ROI whatever you want. There are maybe some trade-offs to consider when should you do a single-phase segmentation or a multi-phase segmentation. You could do a serial process where you do one binary segmentation like I did to label the mitochondria and maybe do another binary segmentation to label the ER, but I think you're probably better off doing a single model and maybe with a deeper network, but a single model to segment both materials or multiple materials simultaneously. Next question is, how well does Dragonfly handle multiple GPU support? In addition, how does Dragonfly handle data sets larger than the amount of RAM you have in your computer? So to William's first question on multiple GPU support, in Dragonfly 2020.1, you can select which GPU you want to use for training, but you can't use multiple GPUs. There have been changes in the TensorFlow architecture that now make that possible. We've done it in the lab, but it's not ready for 2020.1. So 2020.2, you're going to have to wait a while, but the 2020.2 release, which will be coming out in approximately September or October, will allow you to do the training on multiple GPUs. That will greatly accelerate your process. Now, and if you want to do it sooner than that, we've already worked it out in the lab, so we'll have a beta available for that particular feature probably in May or June. Now, the other question, how does it handle data sets that are larger than the amount of RAM you have in your computer? So, Benjamin, maybe you can tell me, is there a mode where you can do instance segmentation on, I'm sorry, semantic segmentation on a slice-by-slice basis for data that are too large to fit in memory? I think the answer is no. And we don't have any case where we've ever needed to do training where the training data is too big to fit in memory. You could always extract out the individual slices. Okay. Next question is, I already answered that question. What are some instances in which you want to reduce the stride to input ratio? It looks like Benjamin gave an answer to that question. It increases the quality of the patches supplied to the model if you don't have a lot of segmented data. It increases the quantity of patches. Yes, so if you can artificially inflate your training data by using a stride to input ratio. If it's very expensive for you to get manual segmentation, that could be a way of boosting your manual segmentation. Now, before I answer any more questions, I am going to have a look. It's run for 17 epochs, so let's just hit stop. And now it's trained for 17 epochs. As I mentioned yesterday, the training is cumulative, so if I were to click train again, it will resume, and it will be the 18th and 19th and 20th epoch. Of course, I could change the inputs, and it would start training with new input data, but it's not starting with randomized weights. It's starting with the network that's already learned. Now, if I take this data set, I'm going to turn off my five slices. I'm going to turn on my full slice stack, and so we have different slices here, and what I'll do is I will select the noisy stack, and I will ask this model, which is just trained only for, 17 epochs, I'll ask it to do a preview on the current slice. So it's not going to be great, but I think you'll see that it can do some job of discriminating mitochondria in this noisy image. So here is the result. Whoops, did not mean for that. Don't know how to make that window change. Ah, there it is. So what we have here is we can see it does a decent job here and here. And I think if I come over here, I can actually select the preview. It made a mistake here in the nucleus. But what you have as a result of 10 minutes of trying, you can see something far better than anything else you could do for 10 minutes of trying. Now, it also, in this case, it picked up these false positives. I don't think I had enough training examples where I had a mask, including areas like that, to say those are not mitochondria. But again, with more training data and with more training cycles, you'd get a pretty good answer. Now, I could take the same slice and I could run a model that I've segmented for a full 50 slice, a full 50 epochs. And again, there's nothing magical about 50, just means it's gone through more cycles. If I select this data set and I look at my binary model, I have one called noisy HeLa segmentation. It's the exact same training data set I just saw trained live, but it's actually been applied for like I say, 50 epochs. So I'll just click the preview button. If I want to use this model to segment all of the slices in the stack, I can just click segment. And I have that done if you want to see the result on the full 50 slice stack. All right. Now, if we look at the results, so it had to load the model and populate it. And so it did a good job of ignoring this. This sample right here is quite confusing to this model, probably because the ER are just so confusing, but it does a not bad job. Now, what I will do, if you want to see, is I will import the results of applying it to the entire data set. So let's see, here is a segmentation. All right. So what we have is a segmentation. I was going to show it to you in 3D so you can start to have a look at it. Now, this is just showing in 3D on, click the button once more, on the 3D data. So you can start to get an idea of where your mitochondria are, how they're distributed. Now, you can do a lot of things to clean this up, including making a better model, but that gives you a very good indication of where your mitochondria are in the data set. We can see these mitochondria are quite independent. It's not like one big, long, connected mitochondrion in 3D. Okay, let me return to your questions and answers. Answered that question already. Next question is, how many slices are required to train the model? The patch means dividing each slice into subslices with patch size. What is the number for augmentation? Okay, so a lot of questions to unpack there. There is no magic answer on how many slices are required to train the model. The more slices you get, the better the chance the model has to learn. You want to have a representative version, a representative training set. So you want to see everything, examples of everything you expect the model to encounter when you apply it on real data. You want to have some examples in the training data set, and not just one of each example. It would be like trying to learn to read, and if you only ever saw one font, it may be hard to extrapolate, or it may be hard for you to learn cursive if you've only seen manuscript fonts. So you want to have a diverse training set. There's no hard and fast answer. We'd like to do some studies where we can look at the effect of different training sizes with different complexity data, and when we have that, we'll be happy to promote it and publish it either in a white paper or a peer review manuscript. What is the number for augmentation? So if it's very painful and time-consuming for you to manually segment training data, let's say you are only able to train 1 megapixel, 1,000 by 1,000 slice, but you'd like much more, augmentation, if you do 2 or 3, it means you'll have 2 or 3,000 extra megapixels available for training. So it's going to apply perturbations to your data. It'll take the exact same patches, but maybe it'll flip them horizontally or flip them vertically, or change the scale, or add noise, or apply distortions. So it's a way of cheating and getting more training data than what you actually put the time in to contribute. So you get to augment your training data with fake data. Next question is, does the loss function always go down monotonically? No, it does not. There is some randomness, or there's some, I don't know if I want to use the word stochastic, but it does not always go down monotonically. It may bounce back and forth a little bit. When you use TensorBoard, you can follow it and you can establish some terms for convergence. Next question is, can deep learning be used to highlight grain boundaries in SEM orientation images so grain size can be calculated? That's a great question. Let's tackle that on Friday's lesson on advanced topics. That would move us from the realm of semantic segmentation to instance segmentation. I'll refer you to a paper called Deep Watershed, which tackles that specific problem of separating grains or identifying, in this case, the grain boundaries. The next question is it possible to apply more than one filter on the processing and train the resultant image? Yes, you can. You you can have as many inputs as you want, and you want to create one output. So the inputs could be filtered images, or the output could be a filtered image, and you can apply as many filters as you want as input cues, although you'll probably find that won't be necessary. And that'll be sort of the topic of our lecture at the CCM workshop on Thursday, where we talk about how you don't even really need to do image processing. You can do deep learning directly on your noisy artifact-laden data. Next question is, how do you create the masks for training? Well, in this case, it was quite easy. I'll show you. We'll go to a 2D view, and I have a, well, I'll just create a new ROI. So ROI tools, new, Gila. We'll do Gila full stack. And let's say I wanted to have, let's turn this off and turn this off. Yeah. We'll turn on the ROI I just created. So this would be my mask. In this case, if I wanted to create a mask, I instead of using the paint brush tool, I could just go into 2D mode and turn on the rectangle tool and say, I want this to be included for training and this and maybe this. And that's how I created those masks. Okay, next question is there a default value for the batch size, or should I always provide it? So it's initialized at 32. And as Ali answers, thank you for chiming in, Ali, it depends on how much memory your graphics card has available. So you can always increase the batch size until your indicator goes from green until red to indicate you've exceeded the memory capacity of your graphics card where you'll be doing the training. Next question is, can I reuse a model for similar samples? Absolutely, yes. And that question is tackled in Sydney's paper on... It's tackled actually in this paper where they look at data sets that have different histograms and the limitations he had on a data set that was trained on a bright sample and then tried to segment a darker sample. He simply normalized the histograms and then the model worked very well. An alternative might be to train the data set with balanced data that spans multiple histograms. Next question is, when selecting slices to train a network, can you select slices in a different plane other than the image plane? When I click image plane, it automatically sets to the axial plane, but I am trying to segment slices in the sagittal plane. I'm sorry, Ross, the infrastructure that we're using right now does not permit you to do training on planes other than what we sometimes call the image plane, or in your case, the axial plane. If you want to use the sagittal plane, what you'll just need to do before you start your workflow is take your image data set. So in this case, let's suppose we take the Gila data set. I can right click and I can go to modify and transform invert. Now at this point, what I can do is I can just move the axis. So if you're interested in, let's say, the Y axis, you really want to flip the or swap the Y and Z axes. And so what you would do here is you would find axis transformation where you have X first and then Z and Y flipped. If you did this, now the primary axis would be the Y axis. Likewise, if you wanted it to be the X axis, then you could choose Z, X, Y. So you have options here to do that. That'll put it in the proper orientation for your data set. Next question, is there a way to create new ROIs while avoiding previous ones? Wow, that's a great question. So if you're trying to create ROIs, and specifically when you add paint to, let's say if I add paint to the ER, maybe I want it to subtract that from the mitochondrion because maybe I'm trying to remove false positives. So in Dragonfly 4.1, the answer is no, you cannot do sort of, well, actually, there is a short answer or a long answer. There is a way to do exclusive painting when you're just comparing two ROIs. But the more important answer is there's a newer infrastructure available where when you're editing a multi-ROI, if you paint a material with one brush, it will automatically erase any of the other materials that are painted in that same area. So it becomes an exclusive brush in all areas. Now, I see that we're already at 40 minutes past the hour. Let me answer just a few more questions. Can you do a video showing how you use the ROI Painter tools to make your data? So as Ali answers, that is covered in lesson 9, ROI Painter, but I think we could make a lesson here. I'll just make a note, add it to the three other videos we need, short videos we need to make, maybe just showing the ROI Painter on Denim so you can see how the ROI Painter tools can be used. Maybe one ROI Painter on the Denim and one ROI Painter on the Gila so you can see the different mechanisms and get an idea. So some good applied examples for different types of materials. Next question is, can you trade training epochs for examples? Well, that's a good question. It wouldn't take you any longer if you wanted to train for 1,000 slices instead of training one slice for 1,000 epochs. Would it be better? I think so. I think if you had more examples, it'd be better than more epochs. But you have those, you have compute cycles. There's nothing really to be lost by, if you have the extra data, use the extra data and apply the extra samples, the extra training time. You know, I just realized something. I forgot to tell you when I looked at the Gila data today, I forgot to tell you that these data are coming from where they're coming from. And I apologize to Roshna. On yesterday's slide, I had her name mistyped, but these images were collected, I believe, in the Zeiss demo lab in in Thornwood, New York, by Roshna. And this data set comes to us courtesy of Dr. Shujun Sun at the Cross Cancer Institute of the University of Alberta. So let's go on to the next question. Is it possible to run an uncertainty analysis at the training phase to optimize the number of images? Yeah, so the question, the short answer is no. The long answer is there's a lot we could do in deep learning research to establish, for a given data set, can I tell how much training data I need or what's a recommended number of epochs? There's a lot of questions and uncertainty in how this is done. And deep learning is actually still so new with semantic segmentation that a lot of these best practices aren't worked out. We try and make it super simple in Dragonfly so you can do lots of different conditions. What my colleagues will do is they'll set up 5 or 6 different networks at the same time and they'll batch them all to remote computers. In fact, if any of you have ever used SETI at home or Folding at home, where you can use idle computers to help advance those scientific enterprises, we actually developed something we call Dragonfly HPC, which behaves quite very much like that. So my colleague will say, all right, I need to run 5 different training scenarios with different training conditions. He'll put them all in a queue and send them to a task master. Then at 5 or 6 o'clock in the afternoon, when everyone is calling it a day and leaving for the evening, they will flip a switch on their computer and say, my computer is now available for Dragonfly HPC. Once those computers become available, they contact the taskmaster and download the job and execute the job. So all of the computers that would otherwise be idle are now processing those deep learning trainings. And when we come back in the next morning, all of the deep learning trainings are done. That can be done with idle computers in the lab, or more practically speaking, it can be done on an HPC cluster, where if you have a number of computers, you could just run this solution where the computers are always saying, I'm available, and they're always contacting the taskmaster to ask for more jobs. So that is one solution for trying to evaluate different training conditions. Two more questions. If we would like to have the size of the mitochondria for all slices, is it possible to do? Yeah, so next week in maybe lesson 20 or 21, we'll do some more quantitative analysis, including slice analysis. So we can certainly use objects analysis to do volume distributions, as we saw in the objects analysis lecture that was described initially in lesson 4 on working with multiroids. But you can also do it on a slice by slice basis if you're interested. And that we'll look at that slice analysis tool next week. The final question, for those of you that are still here, how effective can deep learning be in improving 3D region growing, for example, sensitive to inter-slice connectivity? Is that aspect controllable? So deep learning isn't really used as a region growing tool. It's really used evaluating a single patch at a time. It can evaluate a patch in a three-dimensional context, which might give you better, more robust results than other methods. But to my knowledge, no one has used deep learning training and the deep learning platform or paradigm to try and tackle region growing. It would probably not be a very efficient way to do region growing. That is it for the questions today. We've made it through all the questions. You guys had like 20 minutes of questions. Well, thanks for asking questions. Thanks for sticking with us. We will look at super resolution methods tomorrow, and then we'll also look at some more advanced topics in lesson 19. Thank you all for your questions. Thank you for your attention. Be sure to share these videos on Twitter and YouTube and LinkedIn. We want to make sure that everyone has access to these videos so they can learn what they can do with deep learning, whether it's in Dragonfly or anything else. Thank you all for your time. Stay healthy, be good to each other, and we'll see you next time. Take care.